welcome to episode one of Alma Martyr. My name is Daniel, I'm your host. This podcast will largely be talking to musicians or people involved in music in some way, but we'll be talking about other aspects of their lives, predominantly academic pursuits and other interests. I will say right off the bat that this podcast is not a pro-higher education advertisement. Lots of people are very successful and knowledgeable without higher ed, but the universe is very interesting. And whatever you're interested in, I hope you pursue that interest and study it, whether it be art, science, writing, athletics, etc. And that is what this podcast is trying to illuminate upon. That's okay to be nerdy. Whatever gets you excited for new knowledge. So, to get right into it, you're probably listening to this because you know of Ross Farrar as the singer of the seminal punk hardcore Bay Area band Ceremony. But you may not know of Ross the poet and writer. Ross has published two books that we really digest in this episode. This was recorded on May 18th, 2018 at Syracuse University, where Ross is pursuing his studies in the Department of English there. And we get real nerdy on this idea of trying too hard. We actually may be a dead horse, but I will let you decide that. Is trying too hard a good thing, or sometimes the best way out is always through? At the end of this podcast, Ross reads his poem, Goodbye Forever, so you have the fortune of hearing that, as I have the fortune of hearing that. A few edits. The audio is not great. There's a lot of background in the room, background noise in the room, so I did my best to try to fix that. And I have a quote in here that said, nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. That was by Theobiosis Dobskahansky. That was not Stephen Jay Gould. I was mistaken. If you need to get a hold of me for any reason or have suggestions of people you may find interesting to talk to, my email is lajoiedan@gmail. And I don't really care if you like or subscribe to this. You have free will, so please enjoy. Hello, Ross.
What's up?
This is nice. This is a nice spot.
This is great, huh?
You've got a nice view.
Syracuse skyline.
So, Ross, how do you actually pronounce your last name?
Farrar.
Farrar. Okay.
It's French. It's
français. Is it really French? It's really French. I didn't know that.
Qu'est-ce que c'est?
Comment ça va?
Oui. I know one thing.
What do you know?
Je ne pense que toi.
What's that?
I only think of you.
Oh. I like je t'aime.
Oh my god, I haven't seen this.
Hold on, wait. Give me that back before we get into it. We're gonna get into this.
Bullshit. I can't believe I'm talking about these old pieces of dinosaur knowledge.
Well, we're gonna get into that. Let's step back. Let's step back for people listening on this. Where are we right now?
We are in the Bird Library, sixth floor of Syracuse University, Syracuse, New York. Not the big apple, but the big orange.
The big orange, the Q's, yep. Syracuse. So
interesting story, though, really quick before we go into that. Yeah. You know, it was originally the Orangemen, you know. People still call the basketball team the Orangemen. This was, we're on Native American land, so it is a racist, calling that they used to use. The Orangemen were the people who, the natives to Syracuse. So, but when they got colonized, the white people came in, and this is what the Orangemen, you know, this is what the thing, and it stuck. But now, because we're living in these times, right, we have to turn the orange men to the oranges. And you wonder, you're like, well, this is upstate New York. There's no oranges around here. There's no orchards. There's only apples. It should be the apple men, right, or something. But no, it's the orange men because of that. And that's where we're at right now.
So it's interesting because you're talking about your alma mater here.
Yeah.
And that's actually what the name of what I want to call this is,
okay.
Alma mater.
Okay, good.
And so what I want to get into with this series, and I kind of want to get this into being like a podcast idea, is I have a long time history with music, and I really like music, but I've also, for me personally, I've been involved in science for a long time. And one of the reasons I love science so much is I could actually like tune out and go into my own head and, listen to music for hours without actually having talking to someone and just focus on what I want to do in the laboratory. But I get fascinated by kind of the creative process and, you know, what are your other encouragements in life. So for you, I have a series of speakers that I want to talk to you about this, but for you, it's poetry. So we're here.
Sort of.
But you went
just
on...
writing in general.
Writing in general, creative writing.
Yeah.
And I think that goes hand in hand, because most people listening to this are going to know you for Ceremony.
Yeah.
But they may not know Ross, the writer.
And thank so God.
Not yet. They don't know Ross, the writer, yet. Recently, you did an article. You did a Nosey article. You just ranked your records, and you talked about that. And the
reverse chronological.
Right, you know, in terms of whatever.
In terms of top five.
Top five.
So the bottom was Violence, Violence, which is controversial. The top being the L-Shaped Man, of course. But maybe I would put the demo above the actual L-Shaped Man record.
Wait, it's a Scared People EP going on that. You didn't include
that. Well, we didn't really talk about the EPs. We just talked about LPs, so... But I love the Scared People EP. I think that's a good one, actually.
Scared People is pretty good.
It's pretty good, yeah. It's
yeah.
Pretty good. Not to toot my own.
We're going to talk about that in terms of writing in a second, because I want to back up. But, okay, what I want to do is get into this process. I actually want to get to why are we here. We're here, I'm very glad that we get to be here at Syracuse and the Alma Martyr and why you're out here. But we're going to back up a little bit before we get in. So I have two books. I think, are these the only books that you published? So
yeah.
I have Society Verse here and The L-Shaped Man.
Yeah.
So we're actually going to get into this separate from it being like lyrics based and more just trying to get into it like poetry, creative writing, because you have, you know, a certain amount of knowledge because you've been studying this.
Yeah.
You know. So I want to get into it with that, but let's back up to see how we got here, because I think what I read is you really got into writing initially. I heard that you were living in San Francisco and you started getting into the beatniks. And you moved, because you grew up in RP,
yeah.
The acronym, Roland Park. And then you started to, you moved to San Francisco, what year?
2005.
And then you were working at, I read you were working at a porno store.
I worked at a porno shop, I worked at Wolf Camera, and I worked at City College San Francisco. Those are the three places I worked.
Okay. And so this is after high school, right?
Yeah.
So, and what do you remember what first, like, kind of, like, thing that you read or something that got you really interested in writing? Because before you went to college, you must have had, like, oh, I think I want to go to college for this. I think I want to go study this.
Well, in high school, I was just terrible. I didn't do any kind of schoolwork, you know. I was blowing through all that stuff, smoking weed in the parking lot, etc.
Being a miscreant?
Yeah, I was just a total degenerate. And I didn't really read much in high school. I didn't do anything much in high school besides skate and listen to hip-hop and punk music, depending on the year. And, you know, I didn't start getting into the arts until about a year out of high school. I started... It's because of music. Music really got me into it. I was got into punk pretty heavily, and like Minor Threat, and you know, Black Flag and the Bad Brains and all the classics. And that's kind of what got me interested in words. And then I started reading a little bit more and getting interested in the arts. So I think music was my SIG into.
Oh really?
Into the arts, yeah. Initially.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then so why poetry or creative writing? Do you think they're hand in hand for you?
Well, it wasn't really like that. When I was at the Santa Rosa Junior College, I was doing all kinds of stuff. I was doing essay writing. I was doing short fiction, mostly.
So what year was this before you get in?
I went to the Junior College of Santa Rosa from when I was in high school. So from 2001 was my first class I ever took at the Santa Rosa Junior College, and my last class was 2013. So I had 13 years of intermittently taking courses at the junior college.
Okay. Was it something like you felt like you needed to go to college? Do you have that pressure?
I was just always kind of interested in learning here and there, you know? I mean, I didn't want to go right out of high school because I didn't have that drive. I was, like I said, I was a shithead kid during that time. And so it kind of took me a while to get back into academia. Like, I didn't really start getting back into it until 25. That's when I started taking my math courses and taking it seriously. Because I was in Ceremony and I was touring, like, pretty quickly out of high school we were playing shows. I think it was 2 years after high school we started playing shows. So, and I was living in the city, and it was just a crazy time. But, I did a lot of short fiction. It wasn't poetry at first. I mean, poetry was just kind of a genre that was stuck into literature with me. It was all lumped into one category for me. And then I got to Berkeley, and I did both. Do short fiction or poetry, I didn't know. And I applied for Joyce Carol Oates' workshop. I got into all the workshops I ever tried to do at Cal. I did short fiction there, I did personal narrative, I did all kinds of stuff. And then, my last semester, I applied to a Joyce Carol Oates workshop, and she denied me, and that's when I was like, oh my god, what am I gonna do? She denied me, and I knew a lot of people in the class, because they were in my other workshops, and I was like, wow, these are questionable writers, like, I couldn't get into this fucking class, and it kind of hurt my ego a little bit, I think. So I gave my poems to John Shoptaw, he was a poet, and also Robert Haas. I talked to him a little bit, and they said, you know, your poems have more authority than your short fiction, so if you're going to do the MFA, you're going to have to choose one. You're going to have to try to apply with one strong disposition, and that's what it was. It was poetry for me. So I kind of did it just because people told me I should do that.
So who's this woman's class? John?
Joyce Carol Oates.
She's
a very famous writer.
Okay.
One of the most famous.
Okay, and she teaches a class
female writers.
She teaches a class of...
She was doing a workshop at Cal.
Okay.
Everyone wanted to get into it, you know, like everyone applied. I think she got like 150 applications.
Okay.
And I got denied, and I was kind of a bum. I was kind of bummed out on that, so I went just stuck with poetry. But I still do short fiction.
Right, and I think the poetry is accessible to, you know, lyric writing. But in reading your book, one of your advisors said that writing lyrics and poems are just totally different.
Yeah.
Totally different things. So curious about that a little bit, but... What I want to get into was this timeline. So when did you went to Santa Rosa for a little bit, and then when did you get into the Berkeley? Was this a graduate program, or is this still... they're still undergraduate, right?
Yeah, this is undergrad.
Remember what year?
I was my double undergrad. How do you say that here?
Double major.
My junior college, my city college, which is like not undergrad even. It's right. Even below undergrad.
So like at Votech or a technical school?
It's I was just studying English at the Santa Rosa Junior College. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, usually what kids do, they usually go from high school to their undergrad, or they take like a year off and they do junior college to kind of like... because if you do junior college, you only have to do 2 years at an institution, mm-hmm, instead of four, and you could save money. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I did 13 years of junior college like slowly because I was touring. I didn't really want to commit to doing Cal or whatever, right. So I just did it slowly, and, you know, I was at the Santa Rosa Junior College really heavily from, like, 2009 until 2013.
Okay.
And then I graduated in 2013, and I got into Cal, and that's when I went from 2013 to 2015.
Okay.
I was at UC Berkeley.
And so that was what, a bachelor's program?
Yeah.
A BA. Yeah. So that was a two-year...
two-year thing at Cal, yeah.
And because you had credits from your Santa Rosa college.
Yeah, exactly.
Was Santa Rosa like an associate's degree?
Yeah.
And also in English?
Actually, I didn't have to get an AA. I just had transferable credits.
Okay, just right to Cal.
Yeah.
Cool. So you have a BA from Berkeley.
Yeah.
In English. Straight English.
Yeah.
And then, and I guess this is a good timeline. So you said you graduated from Berkeley in 2013, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is a good timeline. We can start...
2015.
So, we can get into this then, because now we're kind of caught up on your little academic pedigree.
Okay.
We can go into your first book, which was published in 2010.
Yeah.
Bridge 9 Press.
Yeah.
And this is a society verse. You know, you have a nice little, intro about this, book. A lot of this is lyrics. And I want to connect this a little bit. I have some questions about this book first, but I want to connect this a little bit back to your music. I think for me, looking at Ceremony, the first time I really knew that Ceremony was kind of going to be like
this arty band, and like this lyrical band was the Scared People EP, and with It Rained Today Inside My Head. So, four lines, stanzas. Skies above are close to me, forgetting names when shaking hands. Friends and lovers I've left behind, I'm as apathetic as the wind. And I joked with you before, I think you told me, I'm like, I thought of this as kind of like a haiku hardcore. And it's not a haiku, but you...
Yeah, it's along the same lines.
Right, and you nailed, and you kind of encapsulated a feeling there, whereas I feel like before... the demo and, you know, Violence Finance was very, like, an angry, like, record. Scared People came out right after you were in jail.
Yeah.
And you incarcerated something. And then you came out and kind of wrote something in the creative writing process. You wrote something very direct. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Could you remember, like, during that time that you... Did you feel yourself becoming, like, evolving as a writer?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
That's when I started experimenting and getting into the words.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, and I was interested even in when we did the demo ceremony, obviously a little bit. Like, there are some poetic things in there. And there are some poetic things, I think, in Violence too, but this is kind of when things started to really, like, intensify. Especially, like, stuff like that. I'm as apathetic as the wind. Like, what the fuck?
Do you like it now? Like, think about it now?
Yeah, it's fine. I mean, it's young. It's juvenile, but I think it does the job still. You know? I think it still kind of carries an air or something.
Yeah, I mean, that EP is, like, it is pretty solid. But I think the lyrics, you know, you don't spend a lot of, you know, you're not wordy on that. It's an EP, it's small, it's short, it's fast, it's not very wordy, but, like, everything seems very, very direct.
It's pretty punchy, yeah.
Right. And I think that's I don't claim to know, you know, a lot about creative writing process, but one of the things I do know in kind of pursuits in academics is one of the important things, especially in science writing, and I think this would hold true to your field as well, is the importance of being concise and getting to the point. And that'd be kind of hard. Sometimes you don't know your own... sometimes you don't know exactly how to describe your feelings, you know, to describe a move or to paint something. Can you comment about that process as you've gone along? Like, do you look back on, like, previous work and being like, oh, I was totally going about this wrong. I can see a more direct path to explain a mood or a feeling or something in my art now.
Yeah, I think concision is pretty important in any kind of form of art. For speaking of writing, I mean, I think one of the stigmas that poetry has is that it can be too abstract for some people, or it could be too much of a puzzle for people. You know, they can't find the direct line of emotion, or they get caught up in imagery or whatever, or metaphor. But really, poetry is supposed to be something that isn't a puzzle. It's supposed to speak directly to you, and it's supposed to evoke an emotion. That's what our main business is, right? And I think concision is harder to do when you're younger, because things are a little more confusing when you're younger. T.S. Eliot famously said that, later in his life, he said, "Wasteland is basically dog shit compared to four quartets." And one of the reasons why he said that is because Wasteland is very abstract, and four quartets is more concise. It's a more of a direct line into an emotion. And one of the reasons he says this is because I was young. You know, I was full of grape juice. You know what I'm saying? I was like, you know, it wasn't yet wine. Saying it wasn't yet a Cabernet, you know, it was just like Welch's grapes. It's just stuff that seems sweet and it's kind of fluffy and kind of like maybe pedantic sometimes. But as you get older, I think it is a little more important to speak directly about what it is you're trying to get at. Strangely enough, someone like John Ashbery, he went into abstraction as he got older. His poems got way weirder and stranger. His stuff when he was young was actually really concise. And as he got older, his stuff just became so far out, which is kind of interesting, I think. But yeah, for me, I think if you look at something like The L-Shaped Man, the lyrics are very dry and straightforward. If you look at something like Still He Moves You, it's pretty weird, pretty weirdo stuff, you know?
So that brings me into... Perfect segue.
Okay.
Because this brings me into one of the main reasons I wanted to get at this. Because you have a passage here, and I would like you to read it because you wrote it. It's very short.
Okay.
And something I want to get at, it's about Still Nothing Moves You. So
all
just
right.
Read until you see where my pen break is.
Alrighty.
So read this.
Still Nothing Moves You was the group of songs I approached as a writer. By the time we started writing, I knew I wanted to write for a living, and I knew writing was the most important thing to me. Although much of the content is overly written, meaning I may have been trying too hard to be poetic, artsy, etc. But like after every record, I can look back and see exactly what I didn't like. Ruined was okay, violence was too mean, Still Nothing Moves You was trying too hard.
So this is what is fascinating to me, because I came from a field of science which is largely failure, and you have to constantly be trying new things, and you have to be trying new experiments, and you have to constantly be working because success is so rare. And to me, I still have a mindset when I approach art like that, or when anything. You should always try. You should always put your 110% into anything. You should always be working at this. And I loved Still Nothing Moves You. I think you have a lot of beautiful lines in there. There's a lot of, like, wordy words in there, you know? Like, you know, lexicons a little larger in there.
Yeah.
As opposed, as you were saying, L-Shaped Man.
I use the word histrionic.
Histrionic, ebb, you know,
yeah.
other vocab words.
Yeah.
Yeah, histrionic in a public sense. So, but, you know, I liked all that. And so when you say trying too hard, I want to get at this, because I don't think you're wrong. I don't know if now you wrote this in 2010, say almost 8 years now, if you still agree with that passage. And what does that mean, trying too hard? And if you can explain that, because you're from, you know, you've been studying this. You're like, this is your forte, like, in words. This is probably something you have to tell students, you know, like, don't try too hard. So explain that.
Well, I think it's a matter of semantics. I think I might have worded that wrong, or maybe it comes off differently to you than what I was trying to articulate. I think really what I was kind of getting at is that experimentation in the arts can be difficult. Because if you go too far away, from like something safe, you get too abstract or too strange, then it can get away from people. People won't be able to understand it, you know. And it's something like Still Nothing Moves You, using that kind of language and having these kind of very like weird esoteric images, or maybe images that don't even... are kind of anti-images or something, you know, where it's mostly just like a philosophical question or something. That could be hard to give to the people because it's an abstraction, you know. It's like one of those Pollock paintings or like a rock or something. You don't really know what to take from it. You know that there's something there and that it's coming at you and that it's surrounding you, but you don't really know what it is. Whereas if you were to write something direct, like something more on like a scared people line, you can understand it, and you can digest it easier.
But, so is this, forgive me, I don't mean to...
Trying too hard, you could make things a little bit more complicated than they should be.
But do you think that's also pandering to your audience, though? Could that be a criticism that... You're like, I'm worried that this is going to go over my audience's head, or I'm challenging them too much.
Yeah.
But that could also be pandering. I mean, don't you want to challenge people, and you want to...
Sometimes.
You challenge them. I mean, Ceremony has gone through so many different phases, you know, and you guys are always doing new things with your band. No one can deny that.
That's an interesting question, for challenging people. I mean, I think there's a time and place for it. I think there's times when you want to be challenging, and there's times when you want to hook a line of emotion into somebody and have them actually feel something, rather than float around in this kind of, like, cosmic, like, strangeness that's hard to pin down or hard to, like, get at. So, I don't know. I mean, I think every great work of art does a lot of both, you know. It challenges people, it also connects to them in some way, or it relates something, some kind of human universe to them in some way. Because you don't want it to be all too weird, and then no one's going to get anything from it. But you don't want it to be too flatline, because then it's boring, you know. So I think walking that in-between is very important.
Yeah, I think for me, you know, art-wise, and it's interesting you saying this, especially us, like, digesting the passages in Society Verse, but also, like, the album itself. I mean, Still Nothing Moves You, I remember getting that record, you know, many years now, and opening it, and it's the Moleskine look, and it's blank,
yeah.
And it's just Ceremony and Still Nothing Moves You. And it had that statement, and the cover, too, is that single white brick, your dad painted, you know, it's a single, like, white brick statement. So a lot of it was, to me, like, an open book, you know, and that album and the lyrics are meant to be for your own interpretation,
yeah.
You know, and that, but I can also, I guess, see what you're saying, like, maybe people approaching that album, if you put out a blank surface of your art, right, you know, the Moleskine, the music, you know, the lyrics, that is up for interpretation, like, in terms of, is for interpretation, that could, you know, you may lose people, you know, because, you know, so...
It's too weird for them.
It's too weird.
Strange, yeah.
Is that the trying to, you know?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it goes along with it. Because there are artists out there, there are people out there who, you know, they take pride in alienating people in that way, you know, or making it too hard to approach for people, or too strange, or too esoteric, or whatever it is. They think that is good, that is cool, you know?
Right.
Because, you know, let's be honest, in our world, exclusivity is very important to some people, right? To be exclusive means that there's only a certain amount of people to get it, and you're in a cool club.
Right.
And that can be a dangerous thing, too. You know,
So it's interesting. I'm gonna connect this back to something else that we kind of touched on before, and I'm going to challenge this. Because you just brought up Rothko and Pollock, and we'll get into painting. Both of those are, you know, kind of considered abstract. You know, they're abstract painters, and
very, very much in the lime, or in, like, you know, in our, they've become almost cliches at this point because they're so popular.
Right. So this is what I want to get at. So, but, you know, some people approach Pollock, and they look at it and they're like, so what? I can do that. I can make a flower painting. That's often the first thing everyone sees a Pollock painting, and they say that about. But, you know, people are like, oh, but you didn't do this.
Yeah.
And two, you know, there's emotion in Pollock. There's, you know, the hypnotic, you know, I think Pollock is actually, a lot of times when I look at Pollock paintings, I think of it as like a photograph. It has a certain mood, right? Because, you know, he got into the painting. Like, they're very emotional paintings, and they were done usually, you know, at, like, a moment, you know, in his life. Like, that was the feeling that he was feeling, so all these colors swirled and stuff like that. But I want to contrast it with you with something. I really like Andy Warhol.
Mm-hmm.
And Andy Warhol is a pop artist. And by definition, you know, pop art, you know, it's taking about what is popular in society and, like, chain back to you.
Yeah.
And I think Andy Warhol is very accessible for a lot of people because he influenced so much in the later half of the, you know, 20th century. You know, the whole punk cliche, you know, all of that, you know, poster work, you know,
yeah.
That, you know, that all came from Andy Warhol. you don't like him. No. You don't like Andy. And
I think it's just because I haven't been taught the right things about him, maybe, or something. I mean, I like the work he did with the Velvet Underground.
Yeah.
I thought that was pretty cool and interesting. I like him as a character, as a freak. I think that's really, really cool about him. But his art, when I look at it, it doesn't move me anyway. That's all.
Well, I'm just kind of, I'm challenging a little bit because I'm curious about, like, the trying too hard. Like, Andy Warhol often didn't do, you know, it was a factory doing his own paintings. He wasn't...
He was the anti-try-hard.
Yeah, he was the anti-try-hard.
He was the laissez-faire.
And you're kind of talking with your writing as approaching, you don't want to lose the audience, so you don't want to try too hard.
Yeah.
Right? But, like, you yourself, like, some of your artists are the more abstract, open for interpretation artworks. Like,
yeah.
you like Rothko. You know, you like that feeling, even though a lot of people can't see what's the point of Rothko. It's just, like, a blank, you know, surface. So, yeah. I'm kind of, you know, keying as, like, you know, it's, you know, I'm not trying to say, like, it's one or the other, right?
No,
you know, obviously. But I'm curious about your interpretation about this, or
about what?
You know, just like, does the trying too hard, do you think that goes to other forms of art, like, you know, and where do you see yourself?
I think it goes either way. I mean, for me, I think that it's very, very important to be nuanced. You know, I don't want it to be heavy-handed anyway. I don't want it to be on one side of the spectrum or the other. I want it to kind of be, like I've said, like in this nice little comfortable middle point, where there's strangeness coming in, but there's also, what's the word I'm looking for? Like
a foundation? Or
civilian aspects to it, where it's very much, like, you see it out in the world, and there's...
Tangible?
Yeah, sort of, like, you know, just, maybe, like, almost a Lynchian in a way, where, you know... People will see, like, the white picket fence, and they will, with the green grass and everything, they'll call that Lynchian now, because there's something off-putting about it in a way, right? Yes, it has this facade of being, like, very standard, beautiful Americana, but what do we all know that's behind that bullshit of standard, beautiful Americana? There is a darkness creeping, right? There is some kind of, like, looming disparity of some kind, because people obviously can't have that beautiful happiness all the time, you know, the American dream or whatever. There's always something kind of bad behind it. But so I like that kind of, like, nuanced, is this or is this other kind of perverse thing? You know, you got to have a little bit of that perversity, I think, in there. And trying too hard, if someone's trying too hard to do something or to make a form of art, it will come out. People will see that. They will see that it is insincere, and they will see that it's trying too hard. It's like very point blank, you know? So you have to be nuanced with these things. You have to kind of find a way to, like, I don't know, get into the consciousness of people, but without, like, drilling them with a hammer, you know what I'm saying?
So, just curious, just looking at it now, and Still Nothing Moves You, both as, like, the lyrics and the poems here in the book I'm holding, but also as an album. Do you think that was a try-hard record?
I don't know. I think it was a little overt in the way that it was produced, or the way that it was, like, its conception might have been maybe just I might have thought about it just a little bit too much. Like, it was too much of, like, an art project, quote-unquote, I guess. But there are beautiful... I think there are, like, wonderful things about the record. There are things I like about it a lot, you know? I don't think it was a failure or anything, but... looking back on it now, it might change a few things.
So, yeah, one of the things that you write, and I'm curious if this holds true, is Learn Without.
Yeah.
And you go, if I was going to find ceremony, a few songs, Learn Without would be a good way to start. It's a song I really want to write. I want something that was very upset about the world we are living in, something poetic, but something that you could see had liveliness. Learn Without means to watch the people around you and learn from them without repeating their mistakes, failures, idiocies.
Yeah.
Does that still hold true?
I think so, yeah. I think being a witness is very important for me, and very important for any writer. sit back and watch over things quietly to kind of take note of them, internalize them, digest them, and, like, you know, try to make something from it and try to change that thing in some way, right? I mean, we don't want to keep, like, we don't want to keep repeating our problems and the bad things that we do. We want to try to learn from them without becoming the thing, you know, without becoming the animal. Learn from the animal. Do not become the animal. Although that's inescapable, I guess, at this point, without very much the animal.
So, I highlighted here, because I was a little curious, something poetic. So this is, that record came out in 2008. So, again, connecting it
that's
back.
That's like the thesis to Ceremony.
Right.
You want to make something austere and cold and sad and dark, but you also need to have just a tinge of beauty in it.
So you see, you're using the word poetic to describe
poetic.
Beauty, though.
Yeah.
And not the literal, like, poetry. You.
Well, in that case, it's literal poetry. I think that song has, like, a poetic, definitely, like, a poetic vibe as far as the words were put on the page, definitely.
Mm-hmm.
But when we're talking about here, I mean, you know, I'm thinking of, like, yes, the poetic as in, like,
the romantic.
The more beautiful, yeah.
Yeah.
Which is kind of funny. I mean, poetry doesn't have to be like that in a sense, but I think it does get that. Get that definition sometimes.
So, where I'm gonna spend one more nitpick on Still Nothing Moves before we move forward.
Jesus Christ.
I know, I wrote some things about it. No, this one's fun. Difference between looking and seeing, and you have a line that says, in this rotting but degeneration, there's only the ebb. And then, juxtaposed to the page, you have a story written, where you describe yourself in Brooklyn. And you describe yourself being on hallucinogens, you're on mushrooms.
Mm-hmm.
And you said the part I didn't add to the song was about the moment in which I felt everything from that point on was going to be fine in my life.
Oh, yeah, that parking, no, the gas station.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was as if everything was lifted from my shoulders, all the bad feelings, all the compiled weight, and everything was perfect at that moment. Now, I should say that I think you were talking about the eraser making its own way, its only job, because you said, what is it? You say something about the stuck in the overhead, there's no exit, right? So that's actually about the next song, but the way it's presented in the books, it's juxtaposed, the difference.
Interesting.
And in this
there's a lot of errata in that fucking thing right there you're holding. So.
It's what?
There's a lot of errata in there.
Ooh, there's a vocab word.
There's a lot of errors in there. It's a bad.
Yeah, no, it's your first work, though.
Yeah.
I'm glad that we're digesting it now. It's kind of fun to see it. But anyway, so that all moment, I have not had an experience with shrooms, but I've read about it, I've heard about ego death.
Yeah.
We got into this a little bit, and I want to delve into it a little bit, but that moment sounded to me like ego death, where you were kind of giving up the ghost, so to speak.
Yeah.
Right? And we got into this a little bit as an artist, that how important the ego is, and always grappling with the ego. And do you think ego death is important? And do you think that was ego death? And I know that I kind of brought this term on you today, but, you know, you don't have to.
Yeah.
Here's what you think about that with.
Well, I mean, I'm not sure if it was ego death, because, like you said, I don't know. I've never really. It's not in my my lexicon. It's not in my consciousness really yet.
Mm-hmm.
The way I thought about that moment was just a moment in time where things felt a little bit better. And yes, I think one of the reasons why it felt better is because I had just been coming down from a great trip. And in trips, I think this is true to what you were talking about with me today about the ego death, is that when you're on hallucinogens, this has happened to me quite a few times in acid. It's a little more extreme, but you do lose a sense of self, and you become kind of more connected to your surroundings, or more connected to the world at large. And I actually had a conversation with this with my friend Chris Friedman, a youngster here who just graduated. We did music things together. We did a radio show. And his big thing was that when you're on acid, and I agreed with him on this, or hallucinogens, you feel compassion, you feel empathy for everything around you. And I think that is like a detaching of the self in some way. I think you kind of lift out of your skin for a second, and you become more in tune with the world around you, and just like, I don't know, I mean, you can't help but see things as quite beautiful when they're all moving around like that. I don't know how to explain it, really. But I think it is compassion and empathy, which is something I think is severely lacking in this day and age. Sometimes, you know, depending on who you talk to, but just the feel, you know, I think compassion and empathy are kind of lesser emotions I don't know, maybe this might be a canopy statement, but maybe less important to, like, generations coming up right now than it used to be, maybe. But I could be wrong about that, I don't know.
Do you think that, like, there's an emotional detachment because we're in we're in our phones?
You know the whole story, but I don't know. Maybe there should be a class or something where every kid, when they hit around 18 or 19, comes into the acid class and they just kind of drop and walk around campus with everyone.
That's the electric Kool-Aid acid test, right? That's going back to Mary Pranksters. It's going back to your San Francisco.
I think it would be fantastic.
So, Alan Watts, and when everyone quotes this when they talk about acid, I'm going to be a cliche, but there's two quotes that are really famous that should be brought. One was that you can obtain this level of being in the eternal present, because I think what you were saying when you were, you know, on these hallucinogens, you felt connected to the now, the eternal present, and you felt connected to your environment. That can be obtained through meditation. That can be obtained...
Or sex. I mean, come on, you're not thinking about the past or the future when you're doing something
like that.
No, but
you're thinking...
It's an escape.
But there's climax, though. There's a climax that comes, and there's a buildup.
There's
that comes
a peak when you have an acid trip or when you take shrooms. There's a peak like anything else. There's a peak in anything you do.
Yeah, but in sex, though, there's a build-up there, though, right?
There's a work with acid. You put it on your tongue. There's the work right there, and you walk around, and you build with steps, build with breath, build with whatever it is. It's the same shit.
I would think of sex as, I don't know, because I'm totally mad. I haven't done acid, so I don't know.
I thought you were about to say, I've never done sex.
I've never done sex either. I'm going to tell the world that. Never done the sex, Ross.
Man,
purity, man. What
ashamed?
Am I missing?
Wouldn't you that just be a shame? Wow. How can you?
Wouldn't that just be a damn shame?
God, man.
But you know, like, there's what I was gonna get at is like, there's when you're involved in sex. I guess what you're saying, like, oh, this is great because I'm finally having sex, right? Because I'm in the moment, mm-hmm. and like, you're thinking about just the moment where you're getting involved with.
You're thinking about her. You're thinking about him. Thinking about them, depending on what we're talking about here.
This flirting.
Even thinking of they, maybe.
But so you're in the moment, but I still think that you're working towards pleasure. Now you're right. Like this tantric sex, right? Sometimes we get orgasm focused. Sure.
Yeah.
You know, and that, maybe I'm just being a little biased, but there's the idea of just like. Having sex for the sake of having sex, the pleasure just for the sake of having pleasure. But to bring it back to that quote about you can obtain this connection through deep meditation, but acid's like a super highway. It just gets you there faster.
Yeah.
Now there's
the other...
Cuts
out the middleman.
Acid?
Cuts out the work.
Acid?
Yeah.
All right. The other side of this, too, though, is the more sinister side of acid is the famous quote is once you get the message, hang up the phone, right? And that's like you use acid to find something, maybe something about yourself in your subconscious, but once you're there, you know, don't continue to go down that path.
You have the next day, and you eat eggs in the morning, and you drink some water, and you're fine.
It's talking about...
Don't take 100 hits, Jesus.
Yeah, indulging, yeah.
Don't take it all the time. I mean, people do that, of course. Everyone gets addicted to things. I mean, but it's very important to, how do you say it? I had an ex-girlfriend, she said this thing. What did she say? You know, when you're, when people are saying, just do things once in a while, what is that called? Like the
casual?
No. It'll come to me. God, I wish I would have
sparingly
taken drugs. Now I can't remember anything. Presque vu, the French said. Presque vu.
Ross,
it's the tip of the tongue.
Once you get the message, hang up the phone.
It's the tip of the tongue, okay? It's on the tip of my tongue. Presque vu. Presque vu.
Alright, I'm going to move it. We're back.
I got to take a whiz.
You going to take a whiz?
Yep.
Alright, you want to pause this for a second? Here we go.
Okay, I need to make an edit to this.
Oh.
But we were just talking about my ex-girlfriend, Amy Gabbard, God bless her heart, she said, take everything in moderation, including moderation.
Ooh.
Which I never really understood. But it has done its job of making me think about her again when she, when moderation comes up. Anytime it comes up.
All right.
So, there's that.
So this is an ex-girlfriend?
Yeah.
Okay. Gotcha.
Shout out.
Shout out. Shout out to all the beautiful exes out there.
Oh, boy. There's only a few.
You know what's funny is, I think that's actually a good segue. Here we go. Good segue. We're going into RP right now.
Great.
And there's something about, oh, great. You're so excited about this. So, Rowan Park.
If I can never have to talk about ceremony again, I'll be really excited.
Oh, we don't have to talk about ceremony. We're talking about the lyrics.
Okay.
We're literally talking about the lyrics. I'm using Rowan Park as a, in your book, right? Because, well, we'll say Rowan Park 2009-2010. This is a collection of poems, and we're just looking at this just as a poem thing. I'm just using this as a book. And
but these, none of these are poems, okay? They're lyrics.
Right. No, that's
in not poems.
That brings us into this, because we're going to, because I just want to get through this book.
Okay.
And then we're getting into
Let's do it quick. Come on. Get through this fucking thing.
Right. We were just talking about Muse. Open Head.
Okay.
Open Head is someone I get inspiration from, right?
Yeah.
And West End. This is something that is common in Western art versus Eastern art. Is the idea of the Western muse,
uh-huh.
right? As opposed to, I think...
Like the Greek.
Right. Yeah. And so we were talking about this a little bit. Do you ever look at it like... Whereas I feel like a lot of Eastern art is more about the inner self,
uh-huh.
right? That could just be cultural cliches or stereotypes, but just curious about...
A lot of the spiritual work comes from within the self, a lot of the time in Eastern philosophy.
Do you take any of that inspiration in your own creative writing, or do you still find
yourself? I don't think about any of that shit, man.
You don't. You don't ever think about the muse, though, because a lot of like.
Nope. I get the muse every day from the everyday world. I mean, everything that inspires us, everything that creates us, the people who we are echoes. Right. We learn about a song from somebody. We hear it from somewhere else. Someone tells you something interesting. Whatever it is, the people that we are very much indebted to the echoes that are out there. So the muse is constantly there. It's not a singular bird. It's not a female, although often, yes, it is, I guess, sometimes. But, you know, classically, with the Western muse, it is a feminine version of something. But, you know, I mean, the spires on this castle I'm looking at right now, that's somehow going to go into my line of emotion and my consciousness, and it probably will come out at some point with something.
Mm-hmm.
The spires of Syracuse, mine.
The Spires of Syracuse.
Yeah.
That's going to be a name of a new poem.
I don't know.
but you're still drawing inspiration from your environment, right?
Yes. Yes.
You know, is that kind of like Western way of thinking? Or?
It's just a way of thinking. I don't know. Western, Eastern,
Southern,
yeah, Northern. I don't know.
So you don't
Maybe
buy
it. Maybe it comes from the Hyperbians. The Hyperbians? What are they called? The Hyperbians? The people of the ancient Arctic? What were those called?
Eskimos?
No. What were the names of those people? Hyperboreans, that's what they were called. The Hyperboreans. It was like it's this kind of this Atlantis idea, but way, way north, like in Antarctica and like the northern poles. They had the Hyperboreans. They were this like culture of angelic, like, not pastoral, because you have to have some kind of vegetation for that. It was more like idyllic society that lived in the ice, the hyperborns. Anyway, you...
No, it's good.
Could be cool.
So, one, and another line I want to get into, just because I'm from New England,
okay,
I gotta rep this guy. Song, the lyric, back in 84. And I mean,
best way out is always
through. And it's
Robert
Frost.
Frosty.
And I want to touch on that because, New England has Robert Frost, and then, you know, we also have Emma in terms of our poets. But I love Robert Frost. He's, and that may go back to our original statement, Robert Frost just seemed to be very approachable and accessible for everyone.
Yeah,
you know, that's probably a big reason for his popularity. But I don't actually know what that line, or what that line is from, or that, or the
best way out is always through.
Yeah,
I forget what poem it's from too.
But you applied that kind of.
I'm looking something up here for Robert Frost.
Uh-oh.
But yeah, I applied the line. What were you gonna say?
So you kind of applied that to your song, because, you know, that song is about, you know, that song is actually about your birth.
Yeah.
It's about your genesis.
Exactly.
And, but you kind of took this, and does that kind of connect? Like, were you exposed to that in school, or how did you come across that?
I didn't come across that Robert Frost quote. It must have been an academic situation. I mean, I don't think I would have stumbled into him in any other way, unless, you know, like I said, I kind of got into the beat stuff when I was, like, living in San Francisco. Maybe, I don't know, it was an echo. You know, it came into me somehow from some person, or from a teacher, or from, maybe I went into the bookstore, opened up a page, and there I was. I don't really exactly remember how. But Robert Frost, yeah, he's a very accessible poet, but also in a lot of ways he's weirdly nuanced. You know, he'll have the poem, like the one about him and the winter sled poem.
Yeah.
Winter hat. What is that one called?
That's not the two paths in the forest, right?
Stopping by the woods.
Yeah.
That's what it is. And, you know, the last stanza, he says, "The woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep you.
And miles to go before
I
sleep.
And miles to go before I sleep." So it's like, you know, this poem is just, it's basically about going through the woods, right? You're going to a house in a village, and like, it is kind of pastoral and kind of like idyllic, like this thing we were just talking about. But there is this strange, nuanced darkness looming down there at the end of the poem. And that's what you can't pin down in his work sometimes. You cannot pin down, Something Wicked This Way Comes, Bradbury, you know. He has that notion in his work where you don't know, oh God, is this dark? Is this light? What is this thing? Kind of like the Weiland, the Weiland painting, Christina's World. Have you seen that before?
No.
There's a lady in a field, and she's, it looks like she's dragging herself towards the barn, which is in the field. It's a very American, I think it's the Weilands. Is that the name of the family? There's a family of them. There's a grandfather, a father, and a son, and they've all been oil painters. They live up in upstate New York their entire lives. Christina's World. Let me look this up. I always botch the name. Wythe. That's what
Wythe.
It is.
Wythe. There we go. Yeah. No, I've heard of Wythe.
Wythe. It's W-Y-E-T-H.
Yes.
Christina's
World.
They got it. It's at the MoMA in New York right now. People gather around it. They think it's very strange because she looks like she's pining or possibly like yearning for something. She's looking out towards this like pastoral world with the barn, but she looks like she's in some kind of danger. She looks like she might be hurt. We don't really know. And it's this vagueness that is very interesting about the painting, and this nuance that's about it. It's just incredible. You don't really know exactly what's happening. Same thing with the Robert Frost poem sometimes. we really like to be in that kind of in-between state. Is this good? Is this bad? Is this going to kill us, or is this going to imbue us with something? And usually it imbues us with something. We look at these things and we're like, ooh, we like this. We like this strangeness here. This strangeness is good.
That's interesting. It's approaching it. You get...
Nuance is everything, okay? That's what I'm to put. This is my thesis for the day. Nuance is everything.
Well, it's funny.
It's the bomb.
When you said this, like the strangeness, and usually it imbues us with a lesson. Still, me coming at it from a scientist perspective, I can't remember the scientist who said this quote, but it was something I learned in my studies. That I really like. If you find something interesting, stop what you're doing and study that.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Right, and
100%.
And that because science is always about exploration. So if you see an anomaly, like in my own work, like what I was talking about with my dissertation and my stuff and like discoveries I made, I actually spent months thinking, what the fuck am I doing wrong, right? Because I wasn't agreeing with the literature, right? I wasn't agreeing, like what I was finding was not agreeing with what was previously published, because science is always written very dogmatically. Like science is written as, you know, this is it, but it's often not. It's changeable, and it's... should be looking at what hasn't been looked at, right? And it should be looking at the curiosity. And I think you could say the same thing, about good art, you know? You don't want to lose it, I guess, going back to our original, where we were just discussing, you don't want to lose the audience. You don't want it to be, you know, too weird.
Because you want to affect people, right?
Right, you want to affect people.
Interested in what you're doing.
Yeah, you want to give them something tangible, but, you know, something different, something curious. So really quickly on Robert Frost, I just want to do a little segue. I want to rep New England for a bit, and I'll say this to anyone listening. This is really corny, but I was taught, I don't know if this is from, I'm forgetting, I was a young boy or whatever, and it might have been my parents who taught me this. Or someone told me this, but they're like, every person should remember one poem.
Oh, that's good, yeah.
And you should be able to recite one poem, and you should have one poem that you know and that you can recite off the top of your head. And I remember this cliche, like, because there's always a carrot for you, and when you're a young boy, it's like, it's to woo women, you know, like, you want to be able to recite a poem at the top of your head to, like, woo women.
To serenade or something.
Right, yeah. Let's forget about that, but it's probably cool that you can, you know.
It's good for your brain.
It's good for your brain. So mine is Fire and Ice by Robert Frost. Some say the world will end in fire.
You're going to do it? Great.
I'm going to say.
There we go.
You're going to like
there
it?
There we go. Come on.
I was trying to prove that I could do it right now. Because here's
it,
the
man.
Thing.
Prove it to this goddamn world.
Here's the thing. I want you to do it, because I'm going to have you on the spot do your favorite poem that you can remember.
I think I might be able to do one, but I don't know. Keep going. All right.
Some say the world, just for the record, anyone else that ever going to listen to this, I don't have a phone in front of me.
He's lying.
No, I have a phone in front of me. Going to
trip through. Right in front of me right
now. Oh, fuck you. I have only inside my glasses.
All
right. Came
on, hit us with it.
All right. Some say the world will end in fire. Some say the world will end in ice. From what I've tasted of desire, I choose with those who favor fire. But if I had to perish twice, I think enough of my own hate.
There's an element in it?
No, fuck.
Oh, you really
fuck.
That
I
had, one.
I would
really
choose. I think it's enough of my own hate that ice is good. And would suffice. I did fuck it up. Damn it.
Ice is good and would suffice.
No.
That's nice.
God, I screwed it up.
I rhymed it even.
Alright, fine. You go.
I think I might have, I've kind of botched the end as well, so.
Who is it?
John Berryman's Henry's Understanding.
Alright.
It's one of his later dream songs. It's kind of a B-side.
Oh, a B-side poem.
It's good. Henry's Understanding.
Ross also has a computer in front of him.
True. I mean, I have this thing in front of me. Look at this.
Ross is...
Could I not be inspired,
Ross is,
right?
I would like to say that Ross is actually a poet, going to school for poetry,
wow.
And I'm not, so... He was pressure's on.
Okay. Henry's understanding. He was reading late at Richard's down in Maine, aged 32. Richard and Helen long in bed. My good wife long in bed. All I had to do was get into my bed and strip and wake to a hot breakfast. Off the coast was an island, Petit Manan. The bluff from Richard's lawn was almost sheer, a chill at 4 o'clock. It only takes a few minutes to make a man, a concentration upon now and here. Suddenly unlike Bach, and horribly unlike Bach, it occurred to me that one night, instead of warm pajamas, I'd take off all my clothes and cross the damp cold lawn and down the bluff into the terrible water and walk forever under it out toward the island.
I would just like to state for the record that that's not a real poem, and Ross just made that off the top of his head.
Listen, that's something. I did watch the first stanza, though. I get the pajamas mixed up. But whatever.
Okay, yeah, you did better than I did.
I'm a poet, and you know it.
You are a poet.
I'm not really a poet, but I am getting paid to do it right now. It's probably the only time in my life I will ever get paid to write and create and teach poetry. But who knows? You know, that might change. I'm not sure.
So what is it? What is it about that poem that you remember? Because for Fire and Ice, even though I screwed it up, it's short, but I like it because, you know, yeah, it's about the end of the world. It's about, like, kind of being angry, and it's kind of apathetic, you know, because it's just, he kind of says, like, I don't care. He said, ice is great and would suffice, you know, and he's like, it doesn't matter. The end of the world's kind of coming on, but... and so that's kind of my attraction. It's very kind of angry, apathetic poem. But for you, what is it about that really hit you?
I think it's a good question because, you know, like we were just talking about, you should interrogate what you love. If you really love something, you should sit down with it and ask it why. You know, why do I love you? What is the thing about you that I really enjoy? Because I think if you do that, you will, you know, you'll become a better lover, or maybe a better artist, or better at whatever it is you're doing, right? You get to know exactly what it is that moves you. I think for that poem, I like the way that it's narrative. It tells a little story very quickly of a man and his wife visiting a friend somewhere. But there's a nuanced, awful feeling that one day that is going to change and that is going to end, and he is going to have to face some kind of terrible truth. And the terrible truth in John Berryman's case, of course, was himself. You know, he was his biggest, worst enemy. He was a terrible alcoholic, and he had a lot of demons, and he ended up jumping off a bridge in Minneapolis and killed himself. So it's almost like that poem is like a foreshadowing of his own death. He knew that it was going to end in some terrible way, in some dark way. And I like the simple language in it. You can follow it exactly through, you know, right? It's like you're climbing down the ladder in that poem. I really like that about it.
Thank you. I think that was a good explanation of that. We're gonna move on. We're gonna move on from society verse, and there's a good jumping point to L-shaped man here, which this book is not. It's not the lyrics of the record. It's different. It's actually your real poetry. And there's an important point here. And I think what really sums up this book is from your former advisor, Richard Speaks, who writes in this. And he goes, at the time, a veteran punk rocker, yes, and a veteran songwriter, but writing lyrics is nearly nothing like writing poems. Mm-hmm. Now, I think to the commoner, and even to me, who just kind of approaches this, like, in high school, I remember taking a creative writing course, and this is a really embarrassing story, but I'm going to tell you, it's from high school, and we had an assignment, and he's just like, use pick a song that you like now as a student, and I was like 15 at the time, mm-hmm. and bring in the song. We're going to play the song in class, but we're also going to look at it as a poetry. We're going to dissect the song. We're going to look at it as its lyrical content. And I brought, we had to work in a group, and we chose Slipknot, Wait and Bleed.
Oh, hell yeah.
At the time. And then, you know, one of the, I think he did that, and it was a good assignment for when you're 15 or when you're younger, because you kind of see lyrics and poems as the same thing, right? You know, it's a collection of words, it's evoking a feeling, and you can read lyrics without the music to it, and, you know, okay, maybe, whatever, I'm going to think it's a poem. But here was where our teacher got us. Once we actually sat down with the lyrics, whereas we're young, you know, youth, and we're looking at these songs, and like, oh, this song gets me, I identify with this song, and I'm very attracted to this song, I'm getting into it. But when we actually sat down with the poems, we realized that a lot of those words lost their meaning, right? It didn't stand on its own.
Definitely. And
I think that's something that a lot of people don't quite get. And I want you to comment on that because, you know, we're looking at your books here. And Society Verse is a collection of lyrics, song lyrics. And you changed them. I think you tried to present the lyrics,
line breaks,
right, the line breaks, you know, all that. You try to pretend them as poems, but
jam,
right, but L-Shaped Man is actually poems. So let's talk about that as your career coming from music as a lyricist, but realizing you're moving in this direction of poetry. And what is the bigger difference here? I kind of talked about it a little bit in my interpretation, but I don't know if that's very correct, yeah. But what's your opinion?
What poetry is a solitary art. You do it alone with yourself, and there are no other people involved, right?
Mm-hmm.
In a band, you have, in my case, you have five other people trying to create something with you. So, that's the biggest separation, of course. You know, interestingly enough, I mean, poetry when it first started, is the earliest form of literature that we had, right? The poem is like the very, very first thing that was ever produced. And it was originally played to the lyre, the lyre. Is that what they're called? The lyre, the lyre. I always get that. I always botch that. Which is like a strung. It's a string instrument, right?
Right?
It's
the
got
lyre.
A bulbous thing, the lyre, yeah. And it was played like that. And it was a lyrical form of art. You would basically sing in these things, almost kind of like a psalm or a hymn or something like that, right? So poetry went from the oratorical stage into the actual, like, literary pen and ink materialized onto the page, and there you have it for the rest of the world. So, I mean, it's very much a solitary thing. You do it alone, and you just have yourself, and, you know, when you put lyrics to a song, you have this other component, right, which is the music. And the music, depending on who you are, the music's more important. Or the lyrics can be more important, depending on it. I always get in this conversation. But the lyrics gotta be great to go with the music. Like, that's not very true because, you know, you got a band like Nirvana and Kurt Cobain never actually sat down and wrote one line that he cared about or had put any thought to. He classically said, I just put words onto the song just like randomly and, you know, people bow down to it
right.
Like it's some kind of thing.
Right.
Which is a test. To the form. I mean, you know, really, I mean, you can actually just put lyrics, whatever, random lyrics to songs, and you could kind of go into an incantatory state with it, and it can kind of do this thing to your brain where like, oh, wow, like tomatoes on bread, now I'm dead, tomatoes on bread.
Yeah.
People will find some kind of meaning in that bullshit, regardless, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But with the poem, it's a little bit different. And because it's such a niche thing, people who are into poetry are very, very much into the creation of words. The way that they succeed each other, the way that they're formulated. It's a very complex thing to do. So it's another reason why I think like the hoi polloi or the public can't really get into poetry because it is like a highbrow form of art. You have to learn certain things to really get involved in it and to really get like go in depth with it, you know.
So I comment on that a little bit is Iggy Pop in the movie Gimme Danger, uh-huh. talking about the history of the Stooges, and he was talking about as a kid, he used to watch the Howdy Doody show, and that you could write letters to Clarabelle the clown, and he's watched this as a kid, and they're like, please keep your letters 30 words or less, right, because they were getting so many letters, and they're telling all these kids, like, you know, something like that. But he said that stuck with him, and that carried through all of his musical career, was to only write 30 words or less. And so if you look at the Stooges, and you look at, you know, it's all everything is very, like, very simple, very short lyrics, you know?
Yeah, that's great.
Like, it kind of, you know, gets at that. I mean, like, with poetry,
it's kind of similar.
Yeah, what's that line? I can't remember the poet, but he said, a poem is never finished, it's just abandoned. That's good. I forget who said that. It's a quote. I should look this up. Do you agree with that? Do you think?
Yeah, I mean, poetry is a laconic. It's one of the most laconic forms of art. You know, meaning, you're supposed to say a lot in as few words as possible. You know, you're supposed to get across some kind of important thing, some kind of emotional thing, in a very small space and a very small amount of words. So, my metaphor is it's like a grenade, you know, you unhook the hinge and you throw it out into the world and it makes a big impression. Hopefully it will kill a few people, you know what I mean? But, yeah, I mean, I think lyrics are the same way. I mean, you only have a tight amount of time to do it, to a tight amount of space to move somebody, so you better make it good, you better make it quick, you know?
Yeah, I get a little, I'm realizing that I'm... Because, you know, I've dealt with music, and I did a rookie mistake that I think a lot of people do, especially in hardcore, and especially in punk where we come from, mm-hmm. and that's trying to put too many words into a song.
Yeah.
Right? And because you feel limited, and you only have, like, okay, we're a new band, I have all this, like, things I want to get out off my chest, yeah. you know, and we only have 5 songs, but there's so much I want to say, and so then... I'm gonna pack this song so full of lyrics,
yeah.
But then you're up. And then when you're finally like trying to do it live, you're like, well, "What the fuck am I doing?" Or
yeah.
like you're in the studio, you're like, "This doesn't work at all," because you're trying to, you know, you're trying to scream and rap and like put on, you know, all these
oversaturating
your audience,
yeah.
And it's there is a limiter there, but at the same time with lyrics too, like. Especially in other forms, you know, like with rap, you have a lot to say, right? You want to go on...
Yeah, it's like a Baroque form of art. You want to, like, make it very full and very, like, I don't know, like, just packed full, tight, full of images and whatever the hell it is.
But, you know, I just, with you and, like, your poems that you've gone on, like, that limiter... And as you're saying, like, poets are really interested in the limiter. Like, how can we really get this message down
yeah.
quick? But, you know, is that always good? Like, should you... If you have something that's a lot to convey, like...
Then write a novel.
Okay. This is...
Then write an essay.
So...
Then write a short story.
So you went from creative writing into poetry, right? Because, you know, we're in school now for this. I'm getting the feeling that you're stripping out a lot of creative writing, between creative writing and poetry, into that poetry has a limiter. Is that it, or do you think that
it's just form, and it has a space that you're supposed to... I mean, form can be a very, very emancipating thing. If you take a sonnet, for example, it's 14 lines, and you have only that amount of space to put in what it is that you want to get across. It can actually open up tons of different gateways for you. Tons of different tributaries and things, because you think you're in this tight, really tight space, but really what you're doing is you're like, I don't know, you're almost like fulfilling like some kind of prophecy without even really being acknowledging that thing. It just does this weird thing. I don't know, form, people think it's limiting, but it's actually like pretty much a freeing mechanism when you really get down into it.
So I'm just curious about this, because when I think about poetry, and I'm, you know, part of the big reason I want to do this is I'm curious in learning other, you know, you I'm not going to claim, like, I know what poetry is. You're studying it. You're in this. But when I have this kind of commoner view that when a poet sits down, he has an emotion, and then, or she, and the person comes down and, like, I'm going to write what I'm feeling right now, and whatever comes out, you know, it's my stream of consciousness. And then, but you're telling me that poets often be like, I'm going to write a sonnet, it can only be 14 lines. To me, that kind of seems like a word game, right? It's less like emotion and more like, what's my challenge? Like haikus,
sort of.
Haikus, like, what is it, 575?
Possibly, yeah.
Yeah, and so you're like, I got to sit down and just do 575.
Yeah. But when you start doing that, when you're in that tight space, things start to bloom. I don't know. Things start to kind of, like, become bigger, actually, not smaller. It's a really interesting thing. There's got to be a word for it in some kind of culture. I don't know.
So it's cool to think about poetry as a... You almost kind of describe it as a methodology. Yeah. Like, you know, in science, we're, you know, exploring things. Uh-oh. Yeah, you're going to see my notes.
Oh, wow.
But, just for the record, for people who can't see this, Ross just picked up the L-shaped man, which you said you
haven't seen this in years.
You haven't seen, you don't have a copy?
Somewhere.
No. Well, there's things I want to ask you about that. But, yeah, you know, in science you have a method, you know, you have a methodology, right? You know, there's usually certain ways to go about things, and that's also keep track. I've never really thought of poetry as actually having, you know, I'm going to give myself this limiter, I'm going to give myself this methodology, but... By playing the word game, by analyzing the tense and meaning of the words, you're going to create something.
Of course.
Right? Yeah. That's interesting.
You're set to create something.
You're set to create something.
You're bound to it, my friend.
Okay. All right. So you have the second book. We're going to just catch up. You graduated BA from Berkeley 2013. When did you come here to Syracuse?
2014, was it?
Okay, so pretty much right
late
after
2014.
UBA. So you must have applied to grad school in your in your senior year in Berkeley.
My last semester, yeah.
That's what I was supposed to do. So why here? You always rep California. You're definitely a California kid through and through. Your whole dress, your whole aesthetic.
Yep. I came here because it was the only place I got into out of the 8 places I applied to. Simple as that.
But there must have been something about the writing program here.
It's in like the top 10 in the world.
Oh, really? So drop a little knowledge to me about Syracuse since we're here. Like what?
Well, it's one of the most famous MFA programs in the world. It's been a lot of legends have taught and learned and worked here. Everyone from Delmore Schwartz to Joyce Carol Oates to Raymond Carver to Richard Ford to Tobias Wolff, David Foster Wallace was here a little bit with Mary Carr. I mean, the list goes on and on.
Lou Reed.
Everyone has been here. This musician, Lou Reed. Grace Jones grew up and lived here. There's all kinds of people that came through Syracuse University.
Carl Earth Crisis.
It's an artist haven. We come here to suffer, man. That's really what it is.
Could you guys feel isolated?
Of course.
I feel like Cornell has that same kind of idea.
Yeah, but it's prettier, and it's not as bad as the weather in Cornell.
Really?
I applied to that program as well, but I think it's less. I think they have 2 or 4 people they let in a year. This place, they only let 6 people in a year for poetry.
So, I'm only here, L-shaped man. And what was interesting about this is your former advisor. When did this book come out?
2015.
So, okay, this is already you're here at Syracuse, right?
No.
There's another one.
When did we put out L-Shaped Man? Was it 2015? No. It was 2015. No, what the fuck? I got my timeline wrong here.
Open your fucking ears, Ross.
Wow, that's not my ears, it's my head.
Open your fucking head, Ross. We can edit this in post.
Timeline is Why is this important anyway? What is the timeline?
Okay, fine. The point is,
What do you want to know?
I want to know when this book comes out, because Richard Speaks goes soon after this.
It was 2013 this came out, I believe.
2013. Okay.
Yes.
This book.
I think. 14. Doesn't.
So in this book, he says Ross was writing poems about a man named U, and it's a capital U that you use throughout this book. The L-shaped man, a man much like Ross himself. So if anyone who has this book, U is reoccurring. The other thing about this, all the poems, the way the words are, can you describe what this form is that you do? All the poems are four lines.
Yeah.
Right? What is this? How I don't
4x4.
Is it called a 4x4?
No, I don't know. I just there's not a form for this. It's just they're quatrains, which are 4-line stanzas.
Okay.
And there are 4 stanzas. There isn't a tight form for this in poetry. I'll just call them 4x4s. That's what I've always called them. And yes, I use the uppercase U in the same way that people use the uppercase I, first person pronoun. This acts similarly. It's a first-person pronoun you. It's a speculative you. So basically, it's me looking into the mirror, talking to myself.
Okay. Is it like third person, or is that
second person?
Second
you
person.
Is always in second person. But the way that it functions in the book is it's kind of more first person.
Okay.
You. It's very, very strange.
So the reason why I was getting the timeline about this, I'm curious, is like this is something that you seem to develop. You said you don't even know what this is called, but this is a form of
writing. I wrote those in 2014-ish, and it came out in 2015, I'm pretty sure.
Is this a form that you're still doing? This is my major point. This is really poetry that you're seeing now as poetry, right? That this is the contrast to society verse, which is lyrics. Now you have something, all the poems are structured the same, in very 4x, what we're calling 4x4. You have, this person you've seen throughout, and, is this something that you're still doing, or do you think this was a timepiece? Was this, you know how like artists have like, you know, Picasso had the blue period. Like, was this a certain period, or is this something that you feel like is kind of representative of your writing?
No, it was a project I did with the L-shaped man. All the lyrics in the L-shaped man are uppercase U as well. It's me trying to work through a situation, work through a problem.
But they don't have the same kind of, formulation to them, as we were just talking about.
They don't have the 4 quatrain, no. But they speak to each other. The lyrics and the book speaks to each other. There are actually lines that are verbatim exactly the same.
Okay. Do you still find yourself writing like this?
No. I abandoned that. That was just a project that I did.
Okay, yeah, that was kind of my curious.
Okay,
like,
yeah.
That was what I was getting at. It's like, is this what, if someone's like, what is Ross?
No. That was just a time in my life where I was doing that.
Okay, yeah, I didn't see, this is the thing about, like, from an outsider, I'm not studying poetry, like, so if I pick something like this up, I would say, I can easily see that all the poems and the words are structured the same, and they all have the same thing, and then
it's
I'm
aesthetic
thinking,
the reason, too, it looks good, you know?
Right.
What would you call that? It's like a, presque vu. It's uniform.
Yeah.
That's basically what it is.
And this is kind of what, like, I'm just curious, like, wondering for people and people who know you, who you are, is like, is this representative Ross, the writer? And it's not. You know, it's just like a product of your
project.
There's a poem in here that your advisor really gets into that I also really like, and it's Roller Coaster.
Oh, yeah.
What's that for you? I mean,
just a memory, the time I had.
Do you think that's like a good representative poem of this? I'm just curious what you think about it now.
It was the greatest hit, you know.
It was a Roller Coaster.
It was one of the good ones. It all comes down to the image when, you know, it follows the same path as John Berryman's Henry's Understanding that I wrote. It's his narrative. It starts out in a time and place. It has a setting. It has an aperture, as we say. It was the middle of August in California. Okay, this is like stating that this is going to be some kind of story narrative. It tells the story of me going to the roller coaster place. What do you call that? The roller coaster park.
The park.
You know, the Six Flags or something. and it gets to that moment where you're going up the track, tick, 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 you're about to go, and you're about to hit the apex, right? You're about to hit the zenith and then go down. And that strange feeling of releasing your hands from the bar, right? Giving yourself into this terrorizing moment, this thing that's scary initially. It's a presque vu. What do we call this? What do we call this? This surrendering.
Mm-hmm.
That's what this poem is about. It's about surrendering yourself. And yeah, this is a good one.
So this kind of, you did it a little bit, and I'm curious about the reason why I want to pick this apart is why. Is that good compared to... Because you teach creative writing now, right?
Yep.
So one of the things that you do with students, and I don't claim to really know this as well, is, you know, what makes a good poem better than another poem, right? Mm. Like what?
Very
what,
difficult question to answer.
Right, and I know it's art, it's
subjective,
some subjective
reality.
It is subjective. Like, for instance, I hate Emily Dickinson.
I'm with you.
Really? Yeah. You're the fear person that does it.
I do not like it.
So, okay. You know, people love her.
Oh, God.
They gawk about...
It's a cult.
They gawk about Emily
It's a
Dickinson.
Universal cult, man. The worst kind of cult.
And they talk about her, and she, you know... I look at it, and I see... you know, I heard a fly buzz when I died. That was, like, a famous line.
That's kind of cool.
And people love that line. They quote it. I do not like Emily Dickinson. I don't get it. I've tried to. I think she's very... But that's just... You know, I just don't like it, but...
There was a funeral in my head. That's a very classic one.
Right, but why did...
That's kind of almost like a Rain to Dance on it. But I didn't... The funny thing about that, I never read Dickinson before that.
Really?
When I wrote that line, it's very strange. Same brain.
You're like, I hate Emily Dickinson.
People who love Emily Dickinson love Ceremony. That's the thing a lot of people don't know. No, I just told you. Whatever.
We should do a poll about this. Who likes Emily Dickinson? But I was kind of curious with this and your teaching and just using your own poem. What makes a good poem? And in yourself and your own work, what makes it like?
I cannot answer that question.
Oh, but you teach it. You teach good.
Yeah, I mean, I teach what I love. What I love. That's the best way to teach something.
Mm-hmm.
You show somebody why you like something, why it moves you, why you think it works. And you leave it up to their interpretation. They could like it or hate it or whatever. But in teaching, if you are passionate about what it is you're teaching, if there is something in there that you can illuminate for them, it will probably illuminate itself for them as well. So that's what I try to do. I can't tell you what makes a good poem, because God knows there are poems that I love that people hate. You know what I'm saying? It's just, it's a very personal thing.
That's, so in terms of that in academia, though, because we're so kind of hardwired for a rubric, right?
Yeah.
We want, like, a rubric. So how, you know, for an outsider, someone who's not studying this or teaching this, like, it's great, it's freeing that you can tell me that. You're teaching me what you love and you do, but I'm like, how do you grade this, you know? Like, how, I'm still thinking about that. Like, how do you grade this? How do you know... What I'm writing.
Well, I don't
good.
Teach creative writing, actually. I teach writing.
How do you know
and
my?
I teach essays and things like that. We don't do creative work. I mean, that is a good question. How to grade creative work is a little more difficult. I haven't really done that yet. But
mm-hmm.
You know, classically in grad situations, you don't really do. If you do the work and you put in effort and you show that you're creating things, you will get a good grade. It's not really about grades in an MFA program. It's about producing something.
About producing something.
Yeah.
Something of value.
Yeah.
Is it more about, like, you have to be honest? Like, is it just, like, you gotta be something...
I don't know. I know artists, they think that cliche of, you know, be honest in your work. Be powerful. No, I don't know. Honesty is, like, a big thing. And so I know some people that think that's bullshit. Why do you need to be honest? Because, you know, art is a representation of life often. And God knows we know nothing about life at all. It is a total question mark. Divide by zero. Okay. Lynch, go back to him, he famously said, I don't understand why people expect art to make sense when they realize that, and accept that life doesn't make sense. So it's like, you know, we're trying to create these things. We're trying to build something around some shit we don't have. We have no really understanding or idea about. We point to things all the time. You know, we're witnesses to things, but we can't really tell exactly what's going on. There's
See,
no way. Maybe in the sciences you can.
Yeah, I mean,
maybe
I
math you can.
I'm thinking about it with I think it's Gould, Sunjay Gould, and he said nothing in life makes sense except through the eyes of evolution. Right?
Okay, that's cool. I like that.
And that's a biological quote in terms of that we look out and you and I both have the same chemical components of that tree,
yeah.
Right? We're both, everything is carbon-based in this, you know, world, like these living forms.
Yes.
Like, we share a lot of the same DNA genes as that tree. Mm-hmm. Like, we all...
I believe that, for sure.
And then the other thing with evolution, if you want to think about this, art is the idea of change. Like, nothing in life except change. Life is perpetual change.
Oh, yes, baby.
Yeah. So, it's kind of... I don't know. I'm not sure if I totally agree with you about the...
About what?
You know, nothing in life makes sense. You know, like...
Well, this gets to the meaning of life kind of thing.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
there is none. If you think there is, tell me right now what you think it is.
A meaning of life?
Yeah.
No, I'm not... I don't think there's a meaning of life. But... Because, you know...
Or what makes sense about it, then.
What makes sense is
change
the is
sense?
No the pro it's the process. The process life as the process makes sense.
I believe
yeah.
in that. I totally
yeah, yeah.
agree with you.
Yeah. I'm not gonna get into some sort of you know, metaphysical being
yeah.
or something like that, that like there's a purpose and we gotta I mean
But in art we're trying to make an impression on something. We're trying to, as Shakespeare said, put the mirror up to nature. Right? We're trying to like create something that is mimetic of what is out there, right? And you can never get that right, because God knows it's impossible. It's impossible to make an exact representation
right.
of that thing.
Do you think that's also, I mean,
we try to make sense.
The trying to make sense coming to, one of the things I found fascinating in college, something I carried on with me. I took a course called Religion, Search for Meaning, and one of the things, a big takeaway was that humans have transcendental questions that don't have answers, right? And it's, again, with our future, which is not tangible, but we're always like, who am I? Where am I going? What's my point? What's
yeah.
my purpose? Like, where am I going to go into this? But those questions...
It's the quest, it's the propelling forward that makes it worth... Literally.
Right, but yeah, but some people fill in with the God in the gaps, you know?
Yeah.
They're like, I have a purpose by serving God because it's something I can easily explain, right? You know, there's this big omnipotent being in the sky that I'm friends with, and, you know, that's satisfying those transcendental questions, but for the rest, you know, for the rest of us, we're kind of like, those questions don't have answers, therefore there's not a point, but... The art is the grappling with that, though. It's the process of grappling with
yeah.
that. And in science, I think it's also like it's the phenomenon that's fascinating, right? It's the fact that life is existing,
yeah.
right? There's no point to it, right? Evolution's a blind watchmaker. There's no point in that you're going through, but it's
science is all theoretical too. There's nothing factual in there. It's another thing.
You don't think there's anything factual about
science? No. Nothing is factual. They think they might have it pinned, but they don't. It's a total hypothetical experiment. Everything's experimental. Everything is definitely like, it could change.
Well, we could get down a rabbit hole.
We could get
down a large...
Oh, did the universe begin? The Big Bang. What if I call it the Fing Fang? Huh? Maybe that's a whole other theory on it. The Fing Fang is when it came from. It's where it started. A different kind of matter and antimatter came together. One we don't yet kind of understand fully. And ba-bam! There it is, the Fing Fang Theory. Wow, can you believe it?
You know, what's interesting about this is we have this proof that we show people when people talk about the Big Bang.
Yeah.
And that's, we can actually see the edge of the universe.
Mm-hmm.
Think about this. We can see radiation that's millions of years old.
Mm-hmm.
That's the edge. We actually have maps of the radiation that is moving into nothingness.
Okay.
Right? That all came back to a Big Bang. We can see the fucking Bang.
Map it, huh?
You can see the Big Bang. Because as, you know, as matter moved out into nothingness, there was some sort of event, explosion, and you can see that this is occurring millions and millions of years. And we can actually trace it back to a singularity. There's proof that the Big Bang happened. But you present people with proof that a Big Bang happened, what do they get hung up on? Well, what happened before that? Right?
Yep.
And that's it's crazy because, and this is
what's crazy about that.
It's because it's crazy. It's frustration in science. It's like we can show you evolution, and you can show you happen, and then people are like, well, there's a gap in the fossil record between this ancestor and this ancestor, so you know there's still God, and like you want to, the fact that science doesn't provide all the answers yet, as we're still exploring, as we're still thinking, people still get so hung up on it. And then you, to really understand something, to understand something fully in science, takes years of studying the minutiae to actually show coherence in your work. To show coherence
in your theory.
And coherence in your theory. Like, if, you know, this is right, is this right, and this right, right?
Theory is the big word.
So that's the other thing, is, like, people get hung up on that word, on that word, theory.
Theory!
What does theory mean to you as a writer?
Could be or could not to be. That is the question.
Right, that's what people, it's
theory.
It's,
I think this is how it
works. Right, so
I think, possibly, etc.
Has it ever crossed your mind that the word theory has been bashed in by the general public to, as leeway for room of doubt?
I could definitely see that.
Mutating in the environment.
It could be mutated and perverted in some way, huh?
Exactly.
How could that be possible in this world?
How, you know, like...
A joke. That was a joke.
But theory is... But people get hung up... People think about the word theory, and they think, I have a theory, and but there's still that room of doubt. And that's how people... No one ever thinks that... It's weird, and this is me coming back from my training. No one ever really looks at it and be like, theory is actually just a thought. Gravitational theory.
Interesting.
Right? Gravitational, you can see gravity. I can drop it. We're on the sixth floor of this building, and if I step out, we will fall, right? I can throw something and it will fall. I can do it over and over again and show you that it's falling, but and I'm gonna tell you, I think there is something that's pulling us towards the earth. Right? Mm-hmm. I think this thing is called gravity. I can't show it to you. I can't, like, show you what it is because it's not, like, tangible. I can't show you, like, actual lines that are pulling us down, right? But I can show you that if I throw something out here enough, and I'll do it over and over, something's always dropping towards Earth. So, it's a gravitational theory. I have a theory that something's right here that's actually pulling us down. Okay. And now we know that gravity is, you know, due to mass, it's due to,
yeah,
you know,
these words that we've created,
the word, things that are bringing us down, but something is bringing us down towards the earth, right?
So
something's bringing us down. That's theory, is a thought. It's not so much doubt, because the phenomena happens, and that's where people get lost, is it, and you got to be interested in that, is that
The
evolution happens. I can show you evolution happening. So evolutionary theory, we see that all the time. We can directly evolve things in laboratories now to display a desired phenotype, you know. But we can see it happening in nature all the time, you know. You create... When I was in Arizona, there's an interstate that goes between Tucson and Phoenix. And I went out with a scientist. That interstate is now separating two populations of rattlesnakes. There's one on one side and there's one on the other side. And it's called allopatric speciation.
Cool.
So there's a vocab word for you.
All right.
What is that now? It's a man-made barrier. So you have one population over here and another population of rattlesnakes over here. They can't get together and fuck because the interstate's going to kill them, right? Mm-hmm. So you can study that one of these is going to make a different species over another one because of a barrier now, right?
Okay.
That's evolution. That's what's happening. It's the process of change. And that's evolutionary theory, but people get into it thinking like, oh, but aliens could be also be coming down and changing the reptiles, right?
Could be.
Alright, so one of the promises here, so you're in your last year of your master's program here. What has your dissertation been on? What have you been working on?
It's a group of poems. It's a collection of poems. And I'm not too keen on how to defend it yet.
Mm-hmm.
I'm still in the process of learning what it is I'm doing. It very much reads as like a... right now it reads as like a fragmented novel, almost. A fragmented group of poems. Where it's in my voice, and it's very much about self-naming and identity. And it's kind of along the same lines as the you. Self-naming, I mean, I say Ross. I speak to Ross. I say, Ross, what's your fucking problem?
So do you have an internal dialogue that you're going through with this?
Kind of. I mean, it's a lot about, you know, we've talked about a lot about the ego, and, you know, people are very self-centered, and it's hard to get away from yourself, right? And people are always, it can falter on both sides. People say, love yourself. You need to learn how to love yourself. And this is something that I've struggled with my whole life. I've never looked at myself in the mirror and been like, sincerely, I love you, Ross. Or, you know, I've never had the self-care thing or any of that stuff. And one of the reasons is because I'm constantly with myself. And usually it feels a little detestable, okay, to be in this body. So I'm struggling with that. I'm trying to learn. Drug and alcohol addiction has been a thing for me for a long time. Self-destruction. And I'm really interested in this because I think it is important to love yourself. And I would like to get there at some point. But for me, I cannot tap into that.
Yeah, I mean, we're often our own worst critics, right?
Yeah.
I mean, something you talked about earlier that I just want to have that on record. You mentioned to me earlier that when you were younger, you had a privilege to self-destruct.
Yeah, like, for sure.
Is that something that still came through that you're older, wiser man? Like, do you...
Yeah, I mean, I'm, like I said, it's part of what I'm trying to learn about right now, create. It's like, I kind of floated through life. I floated through high school. I did whatever I wanted. I had this kind of, like, destructive mentality, fuck you to everything. And then I got into this band, and I moved people by saying fuck you to everything. People got on my side with that. And I still do believe in it in some aspects. And then I got into Berkeley with being a little more compassionate, I think. I think that's when life started to change a little bit for me. I kind of went through, you know, William Blake classically said, say presque vous here. This is on the tip of my tongue. The road to excess leads to the palace of wisdom. So I think working in extreme aspects of life or extreme experiences in life is something that I delved into, and I dealt in like pretty toughly. But you know, I did it in this way, like whatever. Like I'm just kind of existing and doing what I want, and I could do whatever I want. And, like, gave the middle finger a lot of the time. Now I am here putting that under the microscope and saying, why did you do this? And what are the problems in this? And there's a lot of conversation right now with male privilege, white male privilege specifically. And I think it is an interesting conversation, you know, because I am, of course, a part of that. I have three cardinal sins. I am a white, heterosexual male living in this world. And I have had the privilege to destroy myself and walk upon the earth in this kind of like nonchalant, laissez-faire way, I think. And I think there's a problem in that. And I think there's also a kind of a beauty in that, you know. I tried to get in this conversation with my friend Danica last night. It's like, she's like, you're this person who, you don't know why you're in pain. You can't point to it exactly. You can't speak upon what it is, but there is a very serious tension within you in some kind of way. And, you know, I think a lot of that is just functioning in the world. It's very hard to be a human being, no matter who you are. You know, this world is always constantly trying to make you something that you're not, or trying to make you a part of something that's, I don't know. I can't, that's an ellipsis on that. I can't even explain what that is. But, you know, there's always like this constant existence of pain. You know, this like being in existence is often just really hard and a harrowing thing, I think. We talked a little bit about existentialism today. That might be a part of it, but you know, it's just a fucking drag sometimes. You know? I don't know what else to say. But yeah, I am investigating it, and we'll see what happens. I don't know really yet. I'm getting closer to something.
So we're gonna wrap it up. But one of the things that you said, I was hoping that you would still do for us. Would you read us a poem?
Oh, yeah, this kind of connects, I think, to what
yeah.
I'm talking about.
And I think this would be a good way to, like... So this is a recent poem.
Yeah, I wrote it... I was reading Mary Ruffel's On Imagination. She did a chapbook recently. And she talks about the strangeness of imagination that, you know, artists have done this thing, classic they were, they say, the imagination is the most important thing that one needs to have. It keeps you young, it keeps you interested in the world, but a lot of the times we don't think about imagination in the other way. You know, someone imagined creating the nuclear bomb, okay, which destroyed and killed thousands of people. This was an imaginative act, just like it was an imaginative act for Shakespeare to create Hamlet, right, and to talk about the pains of the world like I'm trying to talk about. And it helped people some ways, but also, you know, imagination can be creative and destructive in both ways, which I think was very interesting. So, I wrote, you know, often what you're trying to do when you write a poem, I think, is like one of the large acts that poets have done throughout cultures. They have said something in a different way. They've tried to bring something into the culture or create some kind of zeitgeist that was a new way of looking at things. A taboo, maybe, or as we say, beyond the pale, something beyond the pale, but classically that's kind of one of our jobs, is to say something distinctive and radical, okay? You gotta say radical shit, this is very important, because without it, then we're just gonna be on our smartphones all the time. So, this poem was written right after I read Mary Ruffel's On Imagination. The version I have it, I sent this to Nikki recently. Of nothing. So it's coming from the iPhone. I don't have the paper in front of me, but it'll do its job. It's called Goodbye Forever. A man sat across from me at a public library, legs outstretched, as if he was at home in his personal space. This man was speaking to his sweetheart on the phone. They were talking about nothing. Nothing in that. They only talked about what they hadn't done that day. I didn't shower this morning, etc. Now, this is actually something, I suppose, but we tend to say it's nothing because it has no emotional value. Lots of things have no emotional value. Bubbles blown from a child's toy gun. The planet moon in the day, vague against the cerulean blue. Footsteps outside now. Beautiful works of art we can't comprehend. They can mean nothing, and that's okay. David Lynch said, I don't know why people expect art to make sense when they accept the fact that life doesn't make sense. Andrei Tarkovsky said, art symbolizes the meaning of our existence. Ross Farrar said, just divide by zero. The woman told the man she needed to get off the phone to feed her child, thus having to end the conversation about nothing And in that moment, I became heavy sad. Sad in that I felt no compassion for the hungry child. I wanted the sweethearts to keep talking and for the child to disappear into my past perspective where it didn't exist yet. I'm sorry, but I don't apologize. I connect this feeling with my increasingly narrow indifference towards children I have no direct relation to. Now, I know that sounds bitter cold, but it's how I felt in that moment, and now I feel nothing. I wonder why I felt that way and have come to this. I'd like them, children, to grow up so they could know how much better it was when they were young, for them to see me and my committee of nothing and feel the same bitter cold indifference for me as I did them, for bubbles and moon and footsteps and valiant art to come deftly forward for a moment, then back into the past, where they keep forever dissolving, then finally, goodbye.
Well,
that's it.
No, I love it.
It's a weird, crazy poem.
No, it's really good. Thank you so much sharing that. And thank you for doing this. You have a year here left.
Yep.
You think you're going to publish your...
I mean, that's the trick. I mean, I got to write this thing and send it out. Hopefully someone will grab a hold of it. But probably I won't, you know, because it's hard out here, to be honest. The publishing world's hard. There's people publishing books all the time, and it is saturated, man, yeah. Big time, you know. But there might be an audience out there. That's like another huge question. Like, is there an audience right now for a young, privileged, white, male, shitbag punk rocker like myself? I don't know. You know, it's hard to say. But maybe someone will want to read The Inner Thoughts at some point.
Well, so we may have another book coming on the way.
Maybe, yeah.
Maybe another book, which would be great.
The tentative title is Ross Sings Cherie and the Animated Dark.
Ooh.
It's a long one.
Kind of sounds like a crazy cartoon you'd watch.
There's some cartoonish imagery in there, I'll tell you that right now. All right.
Well, I look forward to it. Congratulations on being here. Yeah. And dude, thank you so much for... show me around your school and for reading that. And thanks for doing that.
Thank you.
All right.
Bye-bye.